Hey guys, what's up? So, 2998 after 8,461 experience points. I've had enough backgammon. This is time to finish the challenge. Alan Tish, I'm up against. What rating is he? 2511. So no crazy screw ups. And I'll be there. It's been a few setbacks along the way. So many times I've come close. But now is the time to finish the job. 7-point match, gotta take a scary cube to start. But I'm not scared today. I've been out climbing. Anyway, I've had enough talking crap. I'm probably made some mistakes already. Bit excited here. Five. Oh, this is horrible. I don't think I want to introduce another blot here. Alan Tish. Yeah, I need a break from backgammon. I think if this is the final vlog of the challenge to get to 3,000, or, you know, basically the top. Oh, interesting decision now. I can point on him. And he comes in and I'm still la la la. This looks solid. This looks solid. Send it. No, I haven't got a point in board yet. Ah, send it anyway. Come on. Take that. Two on the bar. 17 point pip race lead. Anyway, regardless, I'm going to do a little video vlog for a mini genius quiz, because I did this talk at this UK backgammon tournament where we, sorry, back at the ranch. I've got to focus. What have I done here? It's no super safe play really, so we may as well hit. Double tiger's a bit big. Those fives, they're not playing great, are they? Ah, what's going on here? Well, my friend David Levy said, if you've got to swallow a frog, don't look at it too long. That's the six. Do I hit? It gives him fours, threes, ones, twos, fives, four blots. Or this and two blots. I mean, there's no other. Gotta do it. Gotta do it. Okay. This five is really a problem. Five's really a problem. Oh, a bit of run good never hurt anyone. Ping him. Lose from there. Fair enough. Let's go for the G. Oh, there's a 4-cube already. I forgot there's a 4-cube. One. Too sick. Right, let him win from there. Let him win. going from there. No, don't let him win from there. I was joking. Maybe the switch was enough. Gammon guaranteed. Well, that's a hell of a parlay with three on the board to come in with the ace against 4-point board and win it. Anyway, makes for a bit of excitement. At 35% G's, three on the ace. Give him the 1-6. Don't want to have another one on my deuce point. And crunch up a bit. Maybe I do it. He's got two blots. This is ugly. If he rolls a 6-1-6. Come on, let's do that. Have a bit of fun. If he hits me, even more gammons. Avoid the double blot numbers there. Who knows, it could have been a hit. Ooh. What's he going to do? He ran to get gammon anyway. Didn't stay for the coup classique. Is it over? Did I manage to outplay him? He didn't have any decisions. I did. Just. So, played decent. 1.82. Let's just have a look if there was anything interesting. So what did I do? I came in on the 21 and played to the 11. Oh yeah. Come in on the 23 and even no direct. Didn't even really look at that. 6-4 the... was right, hit on the outside, and interesting, I was looking at the deuce or this, I didn't even think of that, not make the bar, just come around to the 11, gives you an extra builder, I guess, no shots, just double five, and that was it. He made a blunder there, not staying for the coup classique, like we said. Anyway, to be honest, I'm pretty pleased that this challenge is over, but playing... I mean, to be honest, I played the last few matches pretty well, but there's some sixes and fives and fours or whatever in it. And let's just have a look at the rankings now that I'm 3,003. 33rd. Oh, well, I haven't made the top 30 because there's been a bit of grade inflation. I thought 3,000 would do it, but now Frank Raposa's number 30 at 3011. It's another 8 points. You know what? Even if I haven't completed it, I'm happy. I'm delighted to be 3,000. I played enough backgammon. 9,000 odd experience points in 9 months. It's 1,000 a month, so about 30 odd points a day. That's 5-7 pointers a day almost. It's too much backgammon, plus all the stuff I did with the genius quiz. But this blog's only been going 9 minutes. You know what? Why don't we do the genius quiz now? Mini genius quiz. So... I set this up for, there's a UK BGF tournament, very local to me. I was out trying to sell the book, or publicize it a bit. So I came up with a format, because someone came up to me and said, oh, why should I buy a book? It's 100 positions, just odd positions, what's the point? And they didn't fully understand what it is. So We're going to have a go at it. So the first one is an opening. Let me just try to remember. Okay, so villain runs, let's say money game. Villain runs with a 6-5, and you now have a 6-4 to play. So I'm going to give you just a few seconds to think what you do. And if I go too fast, you can always pause the thing and try and keep a score out of 10. We're going to do 10 positions and then discuss them. I haven't got the geniuses, the best 12 players to discuss them with, but I'll do my best to analyze them. So the question is, how would you play a 6-4? If you watch my vlogs on the opening responses, you know this. But at the UK BGF tournament, I think only one person got this right out of 20 or 30 people that were watching the talk I gave. So the right move is not to come out and down, it's not to run, but it's to make the deuce point. I guess you're in a losing game, you're one pip behind and he's on roll. Don't try and copy with a bad run, which gets hit by twos anyway. Context not enough, 18 and 9 gives him too much stuff. So go for the other game plan, making the point. It's quite a hard one. I think you've got to just know it. Like, I don't think many players would come up with that over the board. You probably think someone's a fish if they rolled 6-4 and played it like that, but it's the right play. Okay, so that was the opening game one. Now we'll go to an early game position. Right, so money game, how would you play double one? So obviously, we come in with the ace, we make the 5 point, and the question is the last one. Do we play to the 10 point or do we split to the 23? So just have a quick think about this, make up your mind, keep track of your score out of 10. So what would you do? Split to the 23 or play to the 10? And I think the right answer is play to the 10. And it's not easy because I think when I had this over the board, it's a 0.04 error to come in and play like this, which seemed like the natural play to me. But I guess it's very similar to one of these positions where you're down in the race, you're 11 pips down, you've rolled four, so he's on seven up and on roll, and he's stacked on the 6 point and got five, seven, 10 men in the zone. So the priority is not when you're losing the race to split when he's stacked and ready to attack with numbers like 6-5, 6-4, double five, double six, double four, just to wipe you out. But just to make this play, no rush to come off the ace and focus on your prime. When you're down in the race, it's better to go for a counter prime. Priming game favors you a bit better. You've got more time. And also, I think because you've got your 5 point made already, if we look at the initial, when you make the 5 point with a double one, that checker on the 11 point's kind of redundant, doesn't do much. But when you move it a long one with the final ace to the 10, it bears on the 4.6 away. So I think that's why. So that was quite a nice one that not many got right from an early game. So chapter three, we will go to a mid game, and you've got a 5-4 to play. So the four is pretty clear to play 13 to 9. Question is, what do you do with a 5? Do you hit on the 3 point? Do you play 21-16 or do you play 18-13? Just give you a quick minute to think about it. So the genius is in the book. They got 10 minutes for each chapter of a section. So this would be like the mid-game chapter. They'd have 10 positions like this in 10 minutes. So about a minute a move. But on the vlog, we're going to do it quicker than that to get through them. And also, you can always pause on YouTube or whatever. So, have you made up your mind? The four's down. What's right with a five? Let's have a look. It wasn't hitting. It was just to play 18 to the 18. So that's the initial. So the right play was just four down and 18-13, 18-9 all the way. And the question is why? Why don't we hit? And I guess after this, it's a bit of a parlay. A, he hits you back with threes, 2-1, double one, that's 14-36 of the time. Then you've got to cover. And you're still sort of prime. So even if he fans or he comes in and then you cover, you've got to bring four men all the way around. You don't really have enough checkers here to finish the job. So I guess you just go for this play here. and it creates some bad numbers. It's really easy just to look at your side of the board and your numbers, but unless he pops, I don't know, 4-6, he hasn't really got anything that great here. He can't really roll anything amazing. Maybe double one, four, six, you know, so like four good numbers really. And the rest of the time, like some sixes are awkward. He's got to play off the eight and, I don't know, weakens his structure and he crumbles, and then we got out of field control and target that bar. So I really like that one. That was second best, and quite a lot of people sort of wanted to play this as well, which is really bad, giving up quarter of a point. Sorry, to play 21-16. Yeah, that would just be horrible to lose the anchor in board, so he attacks there. Yeah, I thought that was quite a nice position. Moving on to, so that was mid-game. This isn't really a traditional holding game, but I just thought it was a very interesting position anyway. Quite instructive. How would you play 6-3 here for money? And in the book, there were loads of match score stuff and cube action. We've got a few of those coming up. But how would you play 6-3 here for white? You're down 48 pips in the race. Would you play 15-9 and, I don't know, 8-5 or any other three you like, coming around the corner with the 15, safety in the man, or would you just make the 4 point, leaving the block there? Give you a quick 20 seconds or whatever to think about it. And it turns out it's right by a lot just to make the 4. And I think this just goes to show, when you're so down in the race and you're 40 pips down, you've got literally zero race. You have to maintain contact at any cost. So it just acts as a blocker. So even though it's a block, not a point, it's 4 away. So it's like a 4 away holding game. And that blot's doing the job. If he hits you, you can come in with 3s and 5s and hopefully hit a straggler as he attempts to come in. But it just shows, like, never give up. You know, like, all the plays were right to leave it there until you get down to this one, 15-9, 13-10, which is 0.115, so it's a 1.5 blunder just to do this. And over the board, I promise you, 99 out of 100 people would just play around the corner here and give it up. I like this idea of a block being a blocker, like a acting as a point. Okay, you get hit by some fours, but you get the returns. But basically, when you're stuck so much, find any way. So on to... let's go to priming games. Always, sorry if you saw that quickly, but I thought this was probably the most interesting of all of them. It's from a match, and you're, as white, you're 2-5 down to 7. So 5 away, you need 5, opponent needs 2. 5 away, 2 away. 3-1 to play from the bar. What would you do? This is tough, so have a good think. I guess the choices are hitting on the 24 and coming up to the 21, coming in on the 22 and playing 5-4, or coming in on the 22 and playing 22-21. There is another choice, coming in on the 24 and 5-2. So there's about 4 plays that are reasonable alternatives. That genius quiz book will multiple choice, where I only tried to give the reasonable answers, I guess. It wasn't like a trick question or kind of quiz. All real positions that come up, just how the best players in the world think about them. Unlike me, who's certainly not the best player in the world, but I have improved a lot since the start of this challenge. I think just playing all that backgammon and just the pattern recognition, some of the sloppy stuff I was doing early on, especially with the cube, it just sharpens up the more and more you play. Can't really explain a lot of the moves, you just feel the repetition of patterns when you play so much. So I definitely need a break before I, maybe I'll do another vlog before Monaco. I'm going to go to Monaco in July, so a couple of weeks before that, maybe 2-3 weeks before that, I'll do some training of some sort. But I'm going to take a few months off backgammon. I'm actually going on a road trip from San Francisco to New York next week by Ubers, believe it or not. Don't ask me why. Well, you can ask me why. I'm writing a book called Around the World in 80 Ubers, no joke. Hopefully it will sell more than the genius book, but it should be fun. Anyway, have you made up your mind? Because I'm rabbiting on. So the right play was just to come in to the 21 with no hit at all. And it's right the same for money. So even at the score where you don't really care about getting gammoned, or you don't care, it's five, you're 5-2 down to 7 and you cubed are in and you want to win gammons. So very much gammon go. So over the board, I thought I hit on the 24 and came up to the 21 because I thought he comes in with all ones and twos and then he completely cracks. Whereas this way, except for 1-6 and 2-6, or maybe 2-1 plays and double one, but other than that, I thought he comes in really awkwardly. If he doesn't come in, I can roll a 6 or maybe turn it into a blitz. And I've got time. But by far the best play, I mean, this was close because it just made, but the idea is just in these prime games to make him play. It's a bit like earlier, but if he doesn't roll a 6, he's just so toast. So even this was wrong. Coming up, you don't mind if he hits you and whatever. You don't need that double anchor. You need the 6 to roll off. Next time, coming up to the edge. But just the idea clearly is to let him play. By far, any play where he hits or he doesn't let him play is a massive blunder. It's just an error to make the 4 point. But I like that. Priming games, don't be scared of him rolling a 6. The rest of the time he doesn't and you just toast anyway. So speaking of blitzes, let's go to this position here. And I really like this. It's a cube action. Oh, sorry. If I showed you, if you saw that quickly, I'm sorry. But 11 point match, 0-0. You're 47 pips up. Black has 2 on the bar. And what's the cube action? The great cube action for white and then black also. No double take, it could be double pass. So let's start at the beginning. It's either no double take, double pass, or two good. Four possible cube actions. What do you think? So when I showed this to the British tournament players, most of them didn't double, some of them double take, and no one passed or played on too good. Maybe one person, I think. But the majority, I think, either no double or double. The field was pretty split. And I think I've given you long enough. The answer here is pass. And it's quite a big pass. It's a 0.156 blunder to take. And I think the reason is, even though there's usually the old adage, if you don't have a point in board, it's a take. But here it's 47 pips lead, just massive, you know, 50 pips almost. Black has 2 on the bar, no anchor, and he just doesn't have anything. Like literally, the only thing he has is that no checkers are burn. But he has no structure. It just has 4 on the 6, 4 on the 8, no points. No hope to make a point. So I think it's just usually in backgammon, unless there's huge gammons, there is big gammons here, 34%, but everything's double take early in the game, unless you don't have an anchor and you have no development. So black has literally no development here. That's the key. So if I think about it in terms of parlays, like how's black going to turn this round? The blitz has got to fail, he's got to come in, he's got to make points, he's then got to build a board, he's then got to get a shot, he's then got to hit it, he's then got to be, I mean, to get to a cube, just such a massive parlay, there's no turnarounds. I know Wilcox in my genius quiz book, and the link's in the bio, by the way, on YouTube, so in the comments below or whatever, please click and buy it. I do have a copy here just to show you. That's it. So go on amazon.com, super genius quiz. But here, I mean, the geniuses will give you better explanations than I can. But my best shot is black just hasn't got anything here, even though there's a long way to go. When you don't have an anchor or development, you've got to be very, very careful. So after blitz, there were a section, I think 8 was strategic decisions. So here, white has a 6-4 to play. And he has 3 very clear choices. Level race, but on roll, or just 1 pip behind, but he's made 10, so you're 9 up. You can either just run, consolidating, 24-14. Have a small race lead, and black's got 2 checkers back without an anchor, and you've got none back. You can hit by playing 14-4. Or you can make the deuce point on his head. So 3 very I think game plans, I said, strategic decisions quite interesting. Like, which way do you go? You come to a fork in the road, as Yogi Berra would say, take it. So have you made up your mind yet with a 6-4? So over the board, I ran 24-14, but the 2 point is just so clear. 0.055, and hitting on the four was a huge blunder. Obviously, that's not going to be right. But I thought it was enough to consolidate, as you're rolling towards a cube and he hasn't anchored yet. But I guess it's just too long a game. You run out to the 14, you're still not quite at a cube, and if he anchors, you haven't got a cube for a while. Whereas when you point, first of all, if he stays out, it's double. So he fans, it's double pass. We'll see here, massive pass. And I think that's why. So 9 times out of 36, a quarter of the time when he fans, you just win, you're cashing. And then he can come in, and he can come in badly, and he's got nothing here, and it's not really that big a deal if he hits you. And if he comes in and hits from the mid, he's breaking his mid, and you've got returns. And if he just comes in with sixes or something, it's really ugly for him. Unless he rolls double one, double three, maybe double four, you're just in good shape. Even if he anchors, it's not that bad. So I like that one, but it's very easy to get wrong over the board, I think. Moving on to containment game. You've got a 4-2 to play. How would you play this? So the choices are 20 to 4. Oh, sorry, this wasn't the. Sorry. Yeah, this is the start. So the choice. I just want to. Don't look, don't look, don't look. Initial. Yeah. Okay. Sorry, I haven't set this up better, but I've got to keep putting it on the summary and not give away the answer straight away. But anyway, you're not playing for money here. You're not challenging yourself too hard. It's just a little fun 10 move quiz, like Paul McGrew used to do the 10 movers. So how would you play 4-2 here? Would you break the board with 6-2, 6-4? Would you play 2014, or would you play 2018, 2016? So let's have a quick look. If you break the board, you're 2 pips behind and he's on roll, but no shots, and he comes to you. You can step out, or you can step out like that. So have you made up your mind yet? So the right move by far, 0.01, was to step out like that. And I guess you're not absolutely dead. If he hits, you can come in again and even get flush shot straight away. But if he doesn't, you're just so well positioned. Like, say he rolls 6-1, 6-2, even 6-3, it's awful for him. And 6-5 gets a shot. Obviously, all the doubles are good for him. And it also doesn't waste in the race. But I think, obviously, the key, I mean, this was just way too many shots for nothing. So obviously, this is going to be better. Fewer shots, and you stay further back. But I think this is a bit of everything. Maintains your race, you're not burning, you keep the board. Okay, you volunteer the shots originally, but when he doesn't hit you, you're good. And the pick and passes aren't that many. They look dangerous, but he's got double one, 1-3, 1-4, really, that's it. So it's not so scary to be on the 20 as it may seem, and you can always come back in. So I quite like that one, to step up and challenge, even though, over the board I thought the race is close, so I give him a shot, he's coming to me, just break the board. So I messed that up, quite a bad one. And the last one, let's just have a look at, have I gone through all the others? Yeah, let's turn away for 1 sec. Let's look at, yeah. So this was a cube action problem. For money, you own the cube. Sorry, most of these are for money, but the quiz, I'd say, probably say more actually match scores than money. Maybe it was pretty evenly divided, but maybe 30% of the problems were cube, 35%. So 1 in 3 roughly were cube action, the rest checker plays, but spread between money games, unlimited games, and match scores, various match scores. But for this one, what's the cube action for money? Is it no double take, double take, double pass? Well, that's it. You have three choices. It can't be too good as he has men off. Just give you another few seconds to think about it. He's got eight men off. Okay, so when I showed people at this quiz and it was like, raise your hands, everyone doubled pretty much. Half the field took and half passed. But it turns out this is no redouble. And interestingly, like, even if you bring the checkers in like this, I think it's still no redouble. So it's like a big no redouble here. And one thing that I learned from the geniuses a lot was like, play around with positions until you find the references. So this is still no redouble. How about this? Still no redouble. What about this? Still no redouble. Let's take a man off. Still no redouble. Let's take another one off. Finally, we got our redouble. So it's not until it gets down to this position, which is miles off the original where we were all the way back here with no men off at all or whatever, before we get to a redouble. And quite interestingly, I think it goes like double pass very quickly. If you fans, you see like this. So here's the redouble and here's double pass. So the window is very small. But just get your XG out, fiddle around with it when you're bored of playing matches, and you come up with these references, and I may as well give it away. I've said on the forum before, Wilcox won the quiz and he was brilliant from start to finish. And there's just so many positions where he had references and it felt like, obviously all the players are great in it, but at these problem positions, he just had, even if it wasn't a specific reference, there was something similar he could recall and work from as some kind of reference point. And it just takes all the guesswork out. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed the quiz. I hope you've enjoyed my vlogs, taking 3 months or so off. See you ahead of Monaco. Be lucky, roll well, and I'll just leave you with the good old theme tune again.
Everybody rolls with their fingers crossed.